seems that the sorriest of the characters, Spud, has the happiest of endings.
Yeah.
And the guy who seemed to sort of have his you know, his stuff together at the end of Trainspotting, Renton, Mark, seems he's the one now, at the very end of the movie, it seems like he's the one retreated. He's back in that bedroom where he grew up. Like, he's sort of like retreated in Spud's, you know, sort of growing wings. Is that how you intended it to be, kind of a you know, a contrast, compare and contrast?
It was wonderful to give the person who appeared to have the least future in the first film,
yeah,
to be the one who appeared most chaotic and potentially self-destructive, emerges with a voice that's really valuable. And the voice of the first film, the voiceover,
yeah,
literally,
yeah, right,
agent Renton, is reduced to silence in a way, though he's dancing.
Yes,
you know,
it is. That's true.
He is alive. He's dancing. But he's got nothing to say, really, in a way, because he makes a kind of silent atonement with his father for not having returned for his mother's funeral,
yeah,
you know, which is unforgivable, really, under any kind of moral code.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's Spud who will speak for all of them now. Mm-hmm. And you get this loop back to the original film and the original novel, really. It's almost like he's writing.
Yes.
He's writing Renton's voice.
Exactly.
As the movie ends.
Yeah, and in that case, how did Welsh, the writer, Irvin Welsh, who wrote Trainspotting, did he see, I'm Spud?
Yeah.
Yes.
No, he was cool about that, really. I think he's happy because he kind of lives. He's very interesting, Irvin. He's very, very supportive, and he's in the movie. He plays a small part. Like,
yeah, that's what I read
one.
That after I saw the movie, I missed him. I'm going to have to go back and see it.
Yeah, he's very quick, but he is there. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so he's very supportive of what we do. But when he goes back to those characters in his own books, which he does occasionally, because he kind of cherry picks them for different occasions,
mm-hmm,
he writes them not like we write them for the movie and the actors perform them for the movie. He writes them in their original tone of voice that he has.
Uh-huh.
You know, which,
okay,
is slightly different.
Yes.
As soon as you cast an actor, you narrow down,
yeah,
a novel's character. Because we,
sure,
when you read a novel, everybody has a kind of general picture,
yes,
of, you know, and it'll vary with people, of course.
Yeah.
Whereas in a movie, it can't vary. It is Ewan McGregor, or it is Ewan Bremner, you know. It's those guys now. But he maintains that independent voice of theirs, which is his. So the two sort of running parallel, really, the movie adaptations and the,
yeah,
and the books themselves.
So this is a kind of a tricky question, but I'm going to try to make it clear. You were about 40 when you did the first Trainspotting. So it was a 40-year-old filmmaker about 20-somethings.
Yeah.
Now you're like a 60-year-old filmmaker making a movie about 40-somethings. Do you feel a tighter connection when you were 40 and they were 20, or now that you're 60 and they're 40? Do you feel any stronger kinship in either relationship?
No, I think they...
Okay.
I think this one's a bit more personal in the sense... But I mean that in sense of a bit more acute, a bit more painful in a way,
mm-hmm,
what it admits to. But the sense of identity with it was still very strong in the first one.
Okay.
I mean, I made that in my late 30s,
okay,
and I was a kind of, I mean, again, what one of the things the film is about is how men hang on to their past so much. I was still enjoying myself at that time in,
yeah,
terms of, in terms of their lifestyle, you know, and we used those. Yeah, you know, those appetites we all had,
yeah,
to flavor the first film. But no, I still feel that connection with them now.
Okay.
And they're curiously, and I think it's what people see in them. Obviously, these are very extreme characters. They're not like me.
Yeah.
You know, and they're not like anybody in the audience. You might know somebody like Begbie, but,
yeah,
you don't know somebody who's as violent and psychotic as Begbie.
Right.
I hope you don't anyway.
Yes.
But they do represent something for us, though, I think. The connection with our childhood, with people that we knew, with friendship, those kind of lifetime friendships. That,
yeah.
It's like Tommy says in the first film, you know, it's terrible what Begbie is like, but he's a mate, so what can you do?
Right.
You know, he will,
yeah,
always be a mate. Even though you don't like him, he's,
yeah,
a mate.
Yeah. So I'd like to actually ask now about the more practical consequences. I mean, it's remarkable that you could get the four main actors all available at the same time, and then even Kelly MacDonald, you know, for a bit too. How tricky was that, arranging for all of these actors, and did all of them want to do a remake as, you know, in equal fashion? Or did you have to talk some harder into doing it than others?
No, we were very lucky. They were all susceptible to it, especially,
yeah,
when we sent them the script, because I knew, although the script wasn't finished, I knew the script was good and they would do it, because it had a unique element to it, which is it deals with all four of them equally.
Yeah.
So it's funny, they don't, you don't get the sense from the movie of two of the leads and the two are supporting.
Right, you're right, that's a good
anything
yeah,
like
good
that.
Point.
They have equal time in a way and yeah. equal pathos. You know, their stories mm-hmm. are fully told, each of them. I knew that would attract them. And we built on that. So we said that the deal, we didn't want to get any of the agents or managers involved. So there was no sense of who's had the more, you know, visible career since we did the first one. We said everybody's equal. It's a co-op. They'll all get paid the same. It's not a lot of money because we want to make the money under a certain price. So we're free to do what we want. And they were all into that. The tricky thing, as you said, is trying to find the time in the year when they're all free, because two of them, Bobby and Johnny, are in long-running TV shows, one in New York, one in Vancouver.
Wow, yeah.
And the only time they get off is in the summer. And we had to make the film under curious legal conditions, because you can't own them for that time. They're on loan to you from the TV company.
Okay.
So if they call them back, that's it. They call them back,
wow.
you know. So we had to make it in a rush in their summer holidays. So it's credit to both of them that they gave up their summer holidays to be with us in
yeah.
Edinburgh and shoot the movie.
And then you couldn't have them cut their hair in any particular way if they're on a regular TV series?
Or? Well, legally we couldn't, but,
yeah.
but they turned up and I said I wanted Johnny's hair to be dyed again like it is in the first movie.
Yeah.
And he said, okay, I'll do that. And I said, but they won't allow us to do it, Johnny. And he said, I'll do it. And he just did it. And the same with Bobby. He cut off all his hair, which was in this show in America.
Uh-huh.
And that's their power as part of a TV empire. Because
yeah.
when they're in those long-running shows, they can kind of behave like that. And the
yeah.
company has to respond by giving them a wig.
Yeah.
The company could have responded by suing us. But so far they haven't, those TV companies. So we'll keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, you even have that dye scene in the movie where he's doing it. I go, oh, that is great. Yeah, he is refusing to give up his youth.
Absolutely.
And he's
there
going
it is
for
in
it.
One picture, yeah.
And then just a quick question. I mean, there is, they all are equally represented in this movie, but Ewan McGregor is clearly the biggest star of them all. I would think, was he harder to convince to actually come and be one of the mates now? Because his career is really shot up.
Well, yeah, but he was, I think all of us felt that we kind of owed a debt of obligation to behave as though we were making the first film again. Because it was
great.
Such a big factor in all our careers.
Yeah.
That, you know, in different ways, but,
mm-hmm.
but it was a lift for all of us enormously. It put us on a kind of world stage, really, which
yeah.
is, you're very lucky if you get that moment in your career. So we all felt, really, that we had an obligation, given that we liked the script and we weren't doing it for the wrong reasons.
Yeah.
We had an obligation to kind of treat it like we'd done when we made the first film, when no one was a bigger star than anyone else. Everybody
yeah.
was felt equals, and it was great the way they readapted their kind of like chemistry.
Yeah.
And it was back again in exactly the same fashion. There was no sense of elitism or superiority or anything like that.
Yeah.
And they behaved very well as well in the town, because Edinburgh is a town that is very proud of the first film and very proud of Irving Welsh now. Even though it's a very dark side of the city.
Yeah.
And sort of that we were all felt obliged to kind of tip our hats towards Edinburgh as well.
And just the last question here, very short. Did you have to rewatch your own movie before you did this to make sure that your memory was right about what you did? I mean, like, for instance, right before I saw this, I went and watched Trainspotting again, and boy, does it hold up. But it was just like, I felt like I saw these movies practically back to back. When you're a filmmaker and you live that and breathe that movie, the fact that it's 20 years ago, do you need to revisit it, or did you know it cold before you even began?
Oh no, you have to go back, because you don't
did. Okay.
When you make them, you don't watch them again for a long time.
Ah.
And then you get that curious thing, which is that you hear about them from other people, because people stop you in the street and talk about them or whatever,
uh-huh.
especially that film. So you have to be careful that you've remembered it right. And it is, obviously, as we know, memory's extremely unreliable facility
yeah.
of a human being. You kind of and it was just getting together with the guys on this. The number of stories that we tell were we'd tell a story and someone said, no, it wasn't like that. I did that.
Right.
And you went, no, you didn't. He did that. And it's like, so everybody concocts the memory that best suits them, I think. So,
yeah.
So yeah, you have to watch the prima facie evidence, which is the movie itself.
Did they
but not too much. You know, you've got to be careful about not overdwelling on it, you know.
Now,
so,
did the cast members treat you like a mate or a dad?
It's a mate, really.
Yeah, okay,
yeah,
that's good.
They kind of like, because they don't have much respect for directors anyway, which they regard as being pretty healthy. So no, we kind of all club in together, really.
Yeah.
They're very, very good to work with, for me. And they have a chemistry that's incredible compared to I mean, they're all individually really brilliant actors,
yeah.
but when they get together, something happens, which we obviously chanced upon in the first film,
mm-hmm.
and we're very lucky to be able to repeat in the second one.
Great. It's great talking to you. I've got a million other questions. I'd like to talk about your entire career, but sometime when you do a retrospective of your career, I want to be number one
You'll
in line.
You'll be there.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot, Danny.
Thank you.